Well, we're very, very happy to welcome everyone, those of you who are coming here for the first time and those of you who have continued to come. The People's Forum is a space in which we are unapologetically anti-capitalist, anti-imperialist, anti-patriarchal, a space that we have named an incubator for movements. And those of us who know about incubators, we know that it's to nurture, it's to strengthen, it's to advance the struggles of the working class. We understand that there is a dire need for building community, but it is the type of community that we build that guarantees that we will win, right? And so we want to build a community that is solid, that is politically educated, that understands the roots of our problems and is willing and able to make what we can with what we have and build more of that to advance the struggles of our people. And so we are very much focused and committed to political education. We are very much focused and committed to developing culture that comes from our people. And we're very much committed to social movements that are on the ground, that are in the forefront in advancing our struggles. And so we are very happy, very elated to welcome the New York City Jericho movement and the folks that are doing work that is very important work of uplifting the names of our political prisoners, our prisoners of war, people who have put their freedom on the line for our dignity as people, for our struggles. And so we are honored to have Lenny Foster here. We are honored to have Pam Ham. We are honored to be able to be to contribute to this process. And so without further ado, I want to pass on the mic to Anne, who is also a longtime comrade and friend.
Yes, we are a longtime comrade and friend.
Yeah, I've known Claudia for many, many years. It's really an honor and a pleasure to be here. Not just here for New York City Jericho, we also are New York City Free Peltier. A lot of us wear more than one hat. So in addition to, you know, Leonard, we do all political prisoners and prisoners of war. But I have the honor to present Lenny Foster. So before Lenny comes up, or as he's coming up here, I just want to let people know that Lenny is an amazing human being. He's the former director of the Navajo Nation's
An Honor and a Pleasure Project.
He has been a spiritual advisor to more than 2,000 prisoners throughout this country. Every time he goes anywhere to do a sweat, he will always call us to ask if any of our prisoners are in there. He's done sweats with Sundiata Coley at Allenwood. He was going to do a sweat with one of the Cuban Five, but they had a visit that day. But he'll always ask. He does amazing work. He's an incredible spiritual person. And it's really an honor to even be in the same room with Lenny. And I just wanted to call out, we have a couple of people in the room. Audrey, stand up. Audrey is one of our former political prisoners. Audrey did many years in solitary confinement, and he's still out here doing the work, and he's going to visit other political prisoners. So we really like that. And our sister Pam Hanna, is family of Kamau Siddiqui and mother to Kamau's daughters, one of whom is hers and one of whom is Asada Shakur's. So she has been doing this work for many, many years. She is a woman warrior who I love and respect and have the honor and the privilege to call my friend. So there are probably plenty more people in this room that I could shout out. But Pam and Ojiri, you know, are examples of this struggle as well. And I know we have a, is this that Patooch? And Patooch is here. And Patooch has done incredible work as well. So, that is just fantastic. So without further ado, because we are tight for time, I'm going to let Lenny take this over. Thank you so much, Lenny, for coming and honoring us with your presence.
Thank you. Yeah. Hoka, yupu, hushte, hushte. Dienda no chini. Dikudo hinane ka va hens no edi concert is an inch and all nil up any. Hika deal what your button needs in or jinjits and adils and all this. Ha a shada ana a nao kus. Kudo e be yat eho, be his own, he dat and be his own, he kid it, be his own, he had it, be his own, he cut it, ah, it's going, he knew in a be his own asleep. Yatelchit Jonah Elch Idian Tradine Benjonon Hanatin. Benjonon Sinane case. And he gets Ispiana te Benan Hitzil, Benan Hitzket. And he can have to be at and he nabiat and hits a hats and be at a Kroe, Jopatnitzon, Dikon, Halchen, and Hinalakan, Hitzoka. Benel new, but said ills and all this. Kroe, Nash new, but said this and all this. Aro de a hine crow. People's form or yeo, he go bahas on, hain loud, he can't joke buttonitzon, eddy. And he said, what is sad on his sin, what is son, he yin, what is sad, be at on hunden loud, all this, be none hits ill, all this, be none hits get the arsco. Qua, and get the nen, hi, nahis yow, nahis cow, they con belush, let them loan, do all the conscience, treated and loan, they got a bahas seed, but said they send all it. I shown a shit hard, the in loan, the in youth, a, the in job, the in his journey. All of the conscience, I been ashnit all this, he could out, could all this, but citizen, all that citizen by Islad, all this, Leonard Peltier, he would out, been ailnit, been ashnit all this. All of the conscience, citizen, he been kahin lad all this. A yat el, he been John and Hanat, he know this, he can't be shans and shit hard, the in loan, the in youth, a, the in job, the in his journey. Kia ani einschlon, zestrani, was ist schon truppei, das ist schon eine Rani, das ist schon all. Eut abe, schon sind schon tradi in lohn. Eut tut kudo, eut a. Jo button. Nietz in o jo button so, eut kud a an jet zu dessen. Zu dessen e, be schittend lohn. Ha apiado, schade apiado, na apiado, na o konspiado. Behejon a slain, behejon a slain, behejon a slain, behejon a slain. Oho. Yes, thank you for allowing me to say a prayer in my Diné language. It's an ancient ceremonial prayer, and asking the spirits from the east, the south, the west, the north, Mother Earth, Grandfather, the sunlight, the wind, all the forces of nature to be with us, to accept our humble expression of prayer, and it's an ancient ceremonial prayer, blessing way. So I want to share that with all of you, and thank you for coming today, this historic occasion where we come together and hear our relatives. At this time, I'm asked to be present for this roll call. I'm a Tarn House clan, born for Mountain Cove, and my grandparents, mother's side, River Edge. My paternal grandparents are nomad, one who walks around. So that's how I introduce myself, full-blooded Diné. And the Spanish gave us the name Navajo, but we don't use it anymore. We call ourselves Diné. And so that's how I want to introduce myself by way of introduction. I've been with the American Indian Movement since 1970. I've been with the International Indian Treaty Council since 1991 as a board of directors. And I have the privilege and the honor, the invitation by the Peltier Support Committee, some of the relatives here, Maggie, Ann Lamb, Ann Jeffy, and others, Peter, Jorge, where's Jorge, Leo and Oscar. So these are some of the relatives that I made since my occasion to come to New York City. And I always try to share my thoughts and feelings in a Diné way. So try to explain what I'm saying in my language so you'll know when I teach you also. If you can just learn at least Yat'e, hello. Achehat, thank you. Hakonat, farewell. And these are some of the things that you can pick up. It's pretty easy, but Navajo, Diné, is one of the hardest languages to learn. My father was a Navajo code talker during World War II, and he was a radio operator, and he participated. He was a young man, 17 years old. He's gone now, but he's from Sheep Springs, New Mexico. So he was one of the 400 young Diné that were recruited and enlisted to go to the South Pacific. He was in the 5th Marine Division, Iwo Jima. I'm sure you heard of Mount Suribachi and the fierce fighting that took place by the Japanese and the Navajo, Diné code talkers. So he was one of those, and he taught us the importance of language, prayer, songs, participation in the community, and helping your relatives. So that teaching, the traditional teaching, is given to all our young Diné when they go off to college to learn as much as you can and come back and help your people. So that's what I did. But while I was out there, I joined the American Indian Movement, Denver, Colorado, 1970, at the Indian Center. My mentor was Vernon Balcourt. I'm sure you've heard him, one of the co-founders. He introduced me to Clyde Balcourt, Dennis Banks. Eventually, I met Russell Means, Leonard Crowdog, Wallace Blackout. So these are some of my teachers, and I learned a lot from them, and I engaged in some of the activities, like occupation, take over Alcatraz Island. I went there twice, 1969, 1970, participated. The 50-year anniversary is coming up in November. So that happened November 18th, 1969, and that 50-year celebration is coming up. And it was there that I met people like John Trudell, Lenita Means, Richard Oakes, Pat Janiha, Frank Burnside, Joe Bill, Frank Chase, Jim Vaughn, people like that. Some of them are gone. But that was a movement by the young students, San Francisco State College, University of California, Berkeley, UCLA, and other schools. It was all young people. I myself was a third-year college student, Colorado State University, Fort Collins, Colorado. I hitchhiked out there. The second time I went, it was in December during the Christmas break. A big storm, snowstorm. And I hitchhiked out there. I wouldn't do that today, but that was one of my start in the Indian rights movement. So that's some of the background. Introduction. Like I said, I also did work for 37 years in the prison system as a spiritual leader, a spiritual advisor for Diné and other Native Americans. And I traveled to 96 facilities and help establish and implement the Sweat Lodge program, pipe ceremonies, talking circle. And I worked with Death Row in San Quentin, Potosi, Missouri, Florence, Arizona. And I still have three young men, I call them clients, that are awaiting execution. The issue there was to participate as their last rite ceremony in a sweat lodge ceremony. So I was able to do that. Florence, Arizona, that request was approved, and we did that on a Saturday. My brother that was awaiting, we smoked a pipe, prayed, had a cleansing and purification ceremony, 1999, February, and I was there when they did the execution. And then the second request was in San Quentin, California. And that one was a tough one, because the old boy network, the system, all the wardens, chaplains are mostly men, white men, and they don't like it when Native Americans have rites, sweat lodge, pipe ceremonies. The last rite, they want to use a Catholic priest. But our client wanted a Native American spiritual advisor to perform the last rite ceremony, which was a sweat lodge ceremony. The warden was a woman, Jean Woodruff, and she was overruled. The governor called her at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, said that she was told not, you can't approve the sweat lodge, after it was approved. So she called me into her office and said, we can't have the sweat lodge ceremony. So I said, all right, well, we tried. So that execution took place without sweat lodge ceremony. Then Potosi, Missouri, we had our sweat lodge ceremony, smoked a pipe. So now I got one in Utah awaiting, Draper, Utah. He wants to do the firing squad. That's one of the methods that's still used, either the lethal injection or firing squad. So he's going to do a firing squad. Can you imagine that? United States is still doing that? I myself want the death penalty abolished. So that's some of the work. That's some of the work I did in the prison system. And I went to many, many prisons, California, Oregon, Washington, Utah, Colorado, New Mexico, Arizona, Texas, Oklahoma, and one of my, I had some notable clients. Peter McDonald was one of my clients. He was a former chairman of the Navajo Nation. He did 9 years. He spent most of his time in the Federal Medical Center in Fort Worth, Texas. We did sweat lodge ceremonies and smoked zeclato, Diné tobacco. Clayton Lone Tree, he was at Fort Leavenworth. He was a U.S. Marine guard at the embassy, and he was accused of being a espionage. And I visited him for 9 years. He's out. They're both out. The other is Radmila Cody, Miss former Navajo. She was Miss Navajo. And she was arrested for introducing the contraband into the prisons. And she did 2 years, the federal woman's prison in Phoenix, Arizona. We built a sweat lodge there and had the sweat lodge for the women. And then also there's others that I visited over the years. I had over 2,000 that I used to visit. Now, I recently retired after 37 years. And Leonard Peltier, I started visiting him in 1985 at USP Leavenworth, Kansas. And we did the sweat lodge ceremonies. We did the pipe ceremonies, talking circle. And I visited him for over 20 years, Leavenworth, Kansas. And then he was transferred to USP Lewisburg, Pennsylvania. And I visited him there for maybe 10 years. Then all of a sudden, they shipped him off to USP Coleman, Florida. Coleman 1, Supermax. And one of the other Supermax that I visited that was very extreme was ADX, Florence, Colorado, Supermax. I'm sure you've heard of that. So these are just some of the experiences I had going in there. I used to get anxiety, get nervous, make it hard. They don't want Indians to have their spiritual rights, cultural rights. That's one of the longest wars our country is engaged in. Yeah.
They said the Vietnam War and the war in Afghanistan. But think about it. They've been fighting our people since 1492. And we're still fighting for our rights. So I appreciate your presence here today to support the different organizations that sponsor this. Jericho was mentioned, the Peltier Support Committee, the American Indian Movement, International Indian Treaty Council, and the other organizations that support human rights, civil rights, treaty rights. So it's important we do our part and be obligated and responsible to do these things. So that's some of the thoughts that come to my mind. I saw Leonard Peltier 2 weeks ago down in Coleman, Florida. And that one, like I said, is one of the toughest cases. They don't want to let him go. He's another Geronimo. You know, Geronimo was forced to surrender in, I think it was General Crook that hunted him down. He used Apache scouts to hunt him down in the Sierra Madres. They threatened him, his people. So he surrendered and got on a train. Holbrook, Arizona, they shipped him to Florida. And he spent his remaining days detained and incarcerated in the United States Penitentiary. He died in Fort Sill, Oklahoma. He never went home, never went back to Arizona or New Mexico. So we don't want Leonard Peltier to be like that, so we're fighting. My visit with him, he was disappointed about his application, petition to be transferred from USP Coleman, Florida to FCI Oxford, Wisconsin, where he can go outside, get some fresh air, walk around on the yard, more relaxed atmosphere. But that didn't happen. He's still locked up 24/7 in Coleman, Florida. And it's always on lockdown. It's always on lockdown. We tried to get in there. Oh, it's locked up, locked down. You can't go in and get in. So we have to deal with these. That's just a deliberate attempt to discourage a person from, you know, being free in the mind. He wants to be able to move around, leave his cell, leave the cell block, go outside, enjoy the sun, enjoy the grass, walk around on Mother Earth, pray, do the sweat lodge ceremony, smoke the pipe. But very difficult. And he's been in this condition for going on almost 45 years. Think about it. You're locked up 24/7, 45 years. You go crazy. But that's designed. The prison system in the United States is designed to make a person go crazy. So I feel bad when I see him because he's in that condition. He's in a wheelchair. His health is not good. And one of the requests that I made was to see a visit with, here in New York City, was a visit with AOC, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, to see if she can help us with a letter to the Federal Bureau of Prison, to the Justice Department. But we were informed she's not available. She's a superstar. You know, everybody wants the same thing. They want to meet with her, talk to her, share their complaints, see if she can. So we're not able to do it this time. But I was able to meet with the special rapporteur for the indigenous people Thursday afternoon. I don't know, Peter, my bro here. Him and I went in, talked to Dr. Victoria Corpus. She's a special rapporteur. And I think they work for 6 years. So she's already done 2 years. So time goes fast, especially when you make these requests. We ask her to submit a letter, an investigation into possibilities of release on compassionate release. And Leonard's not in good health. So there's reasons that law, we can use that to get him released and go home. He wants to go home, be with his children, his grandchildren, great-grandchildren. Spend his remaining days in North Dakota. Then the other is to continue the effort to release through executive clemency, since Obama chose not to deal with it. I don't know what's going on there. You know, he's probably scared. But then, you know, when you deal with the FBI, you know, they're trained to use a deadly force. They don't play around. But according to Trump, they're not, you know, he doesn't like them. So we want to meet with Trump and see if he'll act on, you know, executive clemency. And so these are some of our initiatives that we want to do to try to release our brother, help him get released. So we appreciate all your prayers, your help, whatever you can do in your way, with your expertise, your resources. Help us. We ask for your help, your divine intervention. You know, that's what we pray and sing, have hope, have faith. And we want Leonard to be released. You know, he's a very bright, intelligent, he's a talented artist. So if you have an opportunity to purchase one of his paintings, it's a keepsake. Invest $1,000 and get one and put it in over your mantle in your house, over the fireplace. And, you know, help them out, like, help them out that way. And, you know, this prison work is probably one of the most satisfying work, but it's also one of the most intense, dangerous. You know, you always have to be on your toes, keep your senses, maintain your wits. There's a lot of expenses involved traveling to these facilities. And, you know, I visited some of the toughest prisons that I mentioned. And Florence, Colorado is one of them. That's the supermax where all the terrorists are locked up. Death row. I work in death row, death penalty. Like I said, I testified several times to abolish the death penalty. And that's in New Mexico and Arizona. We need to do that in Utah, Colorado. The Federal Bureau of Prisons. They have one Navajo boy in Terre Haute, Indiana. That's where they housed Native Americans on death row. Terre Haute, Indiana, remember that. And yesterday I had an opportunity to meet a brother that's been locked up 46 years, Jalil Montague. And I had a good talk with him, very intelligent also. You know, the thing about the prisons, they keep up with everything. They read, you know, they don't suppress their mind. They try, make it difficult to learn, read, see what's going on in the free world. But, you know, they see what's going on in the free world and keep up with. So we had a good meeting. It was good to see him. And I found out his ancestry is Muscogee Creek from southeast in Oklahoma. So that's good. We're all related. You realize it or not. I refer to all of you as the Blashtla. Blashtla is the five-finger people. That's human beings. That's our Diné word for human beings, Blashtla. So my brother over here, Patooch, long time going to Geneva, Switzerland to talk with the big officials there. He's my relative from the Acoma. They're our allies. We were talking about that. They had a revolution way back, 1500s, down in the what's now New Mexico. Pope, he gathered all the relatives, chased the Spanish out of what is now New Mexico. And he sent runners over to where we live in the Four Corners area and said, get those Navajo boys, they like to fight. Recruit the Navajos and help us fight the Spanish. So we have relations. Even though I don't know him, he might not know me. We know we're Indian. We meet each other, we start talking. We're related. And many others here, Patricia. She's a Diné Comanche. And, she's here. She's here with us, supporting us. Her grandparents, maternal grandparents, were the same clan. So we're related by a Tarn House clan. So let's see others. Jorge, and he's got Leo and Oscar, and others that I met, and Jeffy, Maggie, and Lamb. I might have left some people out. Peter, once again, Peter Clark, the former director of the International Peltier Committee, Defense Committee. Good man. Let's see, who else did I forget here? Oh, Frank. Órale. Muy bien. And, so these are some of the concerns that we have. We want the treaty rights enforced and complied with. They're not dead. They're still alive, and we come to the United Nations to bring these issues affecting our rights, water rights, resources. And now there's a real big concern about our sisters that are being abducted, murdered, missing. So that's a concern that we have here. Our children, the education of our children, the language, the history. And sometimes you just have to do what you got to do. Reminds me of one time I was in a history class at Colorado State University. Dr. Dan Tyler, that was his name, a professor. I said, what are you talking about, all this history? You're not even telling the true history. What about Indian history? What about the true history of what the white man, the white government, they don't even honor our treaties. Talk about treaties. That's history. He got mad. Told me to leave his class. And now was the same time that when Christmas or December came around, I hitchhiked, left for Christmas break from Fort Collins, Colorado. I hitchhiked to San Francisco, Alcatraz Island. I spent a whole month out there. Boy, it was cold. They turned the water off. They turned the electricity off on the island. No heat. It was in December. So I remember that. Now 50 years is coming up for commemoration, celebration of that. I also participated in the BIA takeover, 1972, Raymond Yellow Thunder. Wounded Knee. Wounded Knee was a tough experience, where it was an actual armed confrontation. I myself invited some of my friends at Colorado State Chicanos, the Colorado Chicano Movement. They responded, they came. They didn't know we were going to be engaged in the armed struggle, but they didn't. They responded to it. And some of them are gone. Some of them are, they're getting up in age like me, having some health issues. I talked to them, Chuck Tafoya, Rick Jaramillo, Manuel Ramos, some of these people like that. And then, of course, I met Reyes Lopez, Tijerina, Cesar Chavez, Corky Gonzalez, Ernesto Vigil. You know, most of them are gone. Ernesto's still around. So those are some history. Wounded Knee. I was in a little bighorn bunker, 71 days, survived 11 firefights. If you've been in a firefight, you know how intense that is. It's life and death. They're trying to kill you, shoot you. And we had those firefights for a while. There was almost daily. That makes you grow, appreciate life. Makes you appreciate humanity. You know, smell the flowers and enjoy clean water, enjoy clean air. Enjoy the presence and company of your relatives. I grew up in a sheep camp, me and my sister. I remember when I went to Alcatraz, I hitchhiked from San Francisco down to Los Angeles to visit her. She got after me. She said, "What are you doing? You're supposed to be in college." I said, "Well, I'm on break, Christmas break." "Where were you?" I said, "Well, I was up at Alcatraz Island." "Oh, that's not good for you, because they're going to get you in trouble." So who's they? The Indian, long-haired Indians. But those are the ones that are standing up for treaty rights. Those are the ones that are standing up for human rights. Those are the ones that are standing up for civil rights. And today, it's still that way. We got our Indian people coming to the United Nations to bring our issues to the table, a seat at the table, and talk to these officials. Hopefully, Dr. Corpus will get her letters to the Federal Bureau of Prison. They'll approve her visit to go see Leonard, then talk to Leonard, then get that process moving. Then she has the authority, the power to request and have that request approved to release Leonard. We got to do it. You got to do it. There's no more appeals, no more remedies in the courts. There's got to be a political prayers. So that's what we're doing. But the struggle continues to protect the water protectors, North Dakota, South Dakota, Indian people that came. Maybe some of you went. I want to thank you. If you went and put your life on the line, you were there, then you know what it's all about. So that struggle continues. We got to honor, protect the water. You know, Senator McCain in Arizona, oh, he wanted Navajo water rights. He wanted the water rights of the Hopi, Navajo, Acoma. Trying to take the water from Pima, you know. We gotta fight to protect what water we have. They want to steal it and take it, sell it, pollute it, and then sell it back to you. You know, and no good. That's what we call the water, the sacred holy water. I know the Lakotas, they have a term for inipi, or the water. And, so that's a struggle that's ongoing. And let me see what else is. I guess the avenues that we pursue that I'm talking about, there's we could take these issues into court, litigation. But sometimes we have to think about it. We don't want to lose these decisions, set bad case law. The Supreme Court is stocked with right-wing mentality. They're making it even more so. They want to just stock all of them with right-wing. They're not going to give us our human rights. They're not going to give us our treaty rights. They want to take all, everything that's left, the land, the water, the resources, our dignity, our pride. Then the other is legislation, state legislation, federal legislation, introduce a bill. Then you have to really follow and monitor it, get your witnesses, make sure you're there when the committees meet, and you put your name on the list to testify and give a good statement, strong statement in support. We've done that. Then the other is negotiations. Sit with them. We utilizing the concept of a seat at the table. We say, well, what does that mean? We got to get prepared, get ready, get your mind in order, use a sweat lodge, go to a Native American church, pray, use that smoke, use that fireplace, get ready, put your statements together. And if you smoke the pipe and pray. Then go into the hearing, sit at the table. You got the directors, supervisors, the head chaplain, the head director of Federal Bureau of Prison, president, all of them sitting right across from you. Then you negotiate, speak strong terms, and, but lie, but Trump likes to lie. He doesn't know what he's talking about. So, you know, we wanted to meet with him, but that doesn't look that that's going to happen. We wanted to, because he met with the Navajo code talkers. He insulted them by calling Pocahontas. He said, what the hell is a Pocahontas? We didn't come here to talk about that. Your racism. We came here to honor code talkers for their contribution, Iwo Jima, the 5th Marine Division. But he didn't do that. But he told them, I like you guys. If you ever need something, get a hold of me. Come back. So I told the attorney, David Frankel, I said, listen, he said that. Let's follow up on that. See if he'll set up a meeting. My father was a code talker. I'm the son of a code talker. He made this promise to the Navajo code talkers. See if they'll set up a meeting where we can go in there and let's talk about Leonard Peltier. Release Leonard Peltier for us. And I mean, if he can have meetings with Kim Kardashian, he surely can meet with us, Navajo code talkers. So we'll see where that goes. So these are some of this concept of negotiation. That's the third one. There's litigation, legislation, negotiation. So that's something that we need to prepare for. The other is to follow up on the compassionate release for Leonard Peltier based on his medical. That can happen. Dr. Corpus. The special rapporteur is a medical doctor, so it's only right that she review the files that he's in bad health and release him. She can do it. I believe she can. We pray for her that she... So this meeting is going to happen, hopefully within 6 months. And... let me see. Atila Stona, Pete. Atila Stona Bahadestin Sine Bansis Kiso. Ashin A. Day, yeah. Kashin Sin
Sindedeshat, oh, Chehen, Chedini, Dolis, Arnoldsko, Kainaho Kaigi, for your presence. Thank you for, I know there's other people on the agenda, so I'm going to conclude here. I'm going to sing a song, then we'll sit down and drink more coffee. And so just bear with me as I finish and sing a song here. Chehelam.
A seat. That was really wonderful and inspirational and beautiful. Thank you so much. I need to grab somebody's program. See what's next. I'll bring it back. I was just getting the program. Okay. Shortly we are going to have our wonderful friend Ben Ramos from Pro Libertad, who I believe is over there doing the table. Hey, Ben. Ben is going to give us some very interesting remarks. That was really amazing, Lenny. Thank you for all that wonderful, wonderful history. Thank you for being you. Because Lenny is one of the people who truly is a light in dark places. That man is a light in dark places. He walks into the darkest places in this planet, and he brings light and love to prisoners all over this country. And that is something that is very, very hard to do. Those of us who walk behind those prison walls to visit our loved ones, we know how hard it is. And we are not Lenny Foster, and we are not a spiritual leader, but we feel it too. It's not easy. So Lenny went yesterday and brought light to my friend Jaleel Muntakim, and I thank him for that, because Jaleel really needed some light at this time. He got denied parole for the 10th time. He was very upset. He's been in prison for 48 years. And he saw Lenny yesterday, and he called me today and said, thank you so much, all right? So there you go. It makes a huge difference in people's lives. It really, really does, you know? And as Lenny said, he only mentioned it. But these things do cost money. You got to have money for travel. You're traveling to Coleman, Florida from Arizona. He's not hitchhiking, all right? Told you he wasn't doing that no more, all right? And Ben, where you be? All right, I didn't see you with the lights. I didn't see you with the lights. So Ben is going to do his thing, which he does very well. And Ben has been doing work around political prisoners for a long time, too, working with Pro Libertad, dealing with the Puerto Rican political prisoners and prisoners of war. And he's also known by those prisoners as Ben the Pen, because Ben would write to the prisoners every week, which is a very important thing to do. It's very important for people to get letters and to know that people remember who they are and what they've done. So here you go, Ben. I'm not sure if that's working. Okay.
When I say freedom, you say now. Freedom! Now. Freedom! Now. Freedom! Now. Brothers and sisters, unfortunately, freedom is not free. And Anne started getting into my shtick a little bit when she started talking about the physical needs that we have. But I want everyone to recognize something. There's literature. There's banners. There's food. There's medical supplies and medicine that are sent to prisoners. There's food packets that are sent to political prisoners. There's legal fees that are paid for. There's a whole amount of work that many of you are not aware of in the background that requires funding. None of this here today was brought to you by Kellogg. The National Endowment of the Arts did not endow us with a damn thing. PepsiCo did not sponsor today's event, neither did Coca-Cola. General Mills, General Motors, and General Electric did not sponsor this event. This was brought to you by People's Power. Brothers and sisters, we have to turn the root of all evil into a tool of liberation, because every time you give Jericho a dollar, there's posters that are produced. Every time you give us a dollar, palm cards that we give out at every event that we go to. Every time you give us a dollar, we're able to make incredible banners. Every time you give us a dollar, we're able to maintain the website. Every time you give us a dollar, we are able to send Jaleel food packets. Every time you give us a dollar, we're able to send medicine. We're able to bring people to see political prisoners. We're able to travel. Brothers and sisters, as this goes around, I need you to bless it. $1, $5, $10, $20, $50, $100. If you are unsure, you have your checks with you. If you're unsure what to give, give us the blank check and we will fill it out for you. We take credit cards and debit cards. We don't have the e-reader with us right now. Just give it to us. We'll mail it back to you. We'll take out the donation in your name. But I need all of you to start putting money. Think about sacrificing that one song that you're not gonna, that Pete Seeger song you're gonna download from iTunes. Sacrifice that. Give the money to the political prisoners. Think about, instead of buying that little candy bar that you were gonna buy on your way out, that gluten-free thing that you were gonna eat, that microbiotic, wild-crafted, organic thing you were gonna buy, sacrifice that. And put that donation in the bucket. Brothers and sisters, there's a lot of work that takes place not on these stages. There's a lot of work that takes place behind the walls, behind the scenes. There's commissary that we have to give to political prisoners. There's literature and posters. There's donations to family members that cannot see their incarcerated family. They need our support to get them to those prisons. We all know that many of these prisons are in no man's land. We need to help these families. Jericho does this on a daily basis, and we can only do it through your support. So brothers and sisters, those were my remarkable remarks. I'm begging for money. So make sure as that bucket gets to you that you do what you can do. Please support us. $1, $5, $10, $20, $50, $100, it helps us all. Brothers and sisters, when I say freedom, you say now. Freedom.
Now.
Freedom.
Now.
Freedom.
Now.
Now is the time to pay for that freedom. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ben. Okay, well, I hope everybody was as generous as they could be. So this will be a big help for any little thing we needed for. Now, next up on this program, we were supposed to have Spirit Child, who is going to give us a nice cultural presentation. He may be running late. He does a program on Rikers Island in the mornings on Sunday with young people on Rikers Island doing, writing and poetry and stuff, which is really fantastic. So we will segue instead into our friend Dan Battaglia, who is the secretary of the International Leonard Peltier Defense Committee. He's on the board. He's a secretary. He has a pretty amazing presentation himself with several things about Leonard's case that people may or may not know. And it will be very interesting. And we're also going to have the world, I repeat, world premiere of this video that nobody has seen yet except for a few select individuals. So it should be really exciting. We're going to hear Leonard himself, all right? So, and that will be from a trial, right?
Yes.
And it's Leonard's sentencing statement?
The only audio that exists from
Leonard's trial. So that will be really amazing. So I think that, you know, that is fantastic. And I don't know if Dan has to set up or anything with his video stuff, but sure. And it's great to see you again anyway. He does a tremendous work, too. He's been doing this for a long time. I'll give you back your program.
Yeah, that's fine. So, folks, we'll have a brief 30-second to one-minute intermission, if you'll just bear with me. If anybody has funny jokes, please share them. If you need to use the facilities, now might be a good time, but I stress the 30 to 60-second thing. So we'll see. Do we know where Lenny is right now?
Outside.
He's outside? Okay, well, we'll try to give him a minute to just come back in, because I would like to thank him in person again as I'm up here, because Lenny's had a big influence on me too. So he's an outstanding individual. Okay, so I guess we're going to get started. My name is Dan Battaglia. I am the secretary for the International Leonard Peltier Defense Committee. Thank you to everyone who's coming, and hello to everyone watching on the internet, and hello to everyone here as well. I'm from Edison, New Jersey, so I came under the river on the train today. And I actually got involved with Leonard's case several years ago, around the year 2000, when I was introduced to it, doing a three-minute argument towards the betterment of needing conditions for a college assignment. And in the research of that, that's when I found out about Leonard's case, and I've been involved ever since. And now that Lenny has come back, I just wanted to say thank you from my heart to Lenny for all that he's done. As a matter of fact, I do remember, I don't know if Lenny remembers, but the first time I ever spoke to Lenny was about 6 years ago, and he was traveling from one sweat lodge ceremony at a prison to another. And I just want to point out, before I start talking about the case and what we're really dealing with here, I want to point out that until 1978, it was illegal for Lenny Foster to practice his religion in this country. Okay? That is the kind of mindset that we're dealing with here. So I want you guys to keep that in mind. Until 1978, it was illegal for Lenny Foster to practice his own religion in this country, okay? So leading up to anything before 1978, technically, it was a crime, okay? And there's a great book that really describes the mindset of what we're dealing with here. It's a classic. Some of you who are familiar with the literature at the time, you might know about it. It's called Wasichu, okay? Wasichu, the Continuing Indian Wars. It's by Bruce Johansson and Roberto Maestas. I hope I didn't butcher his name. But do we know what Wasichu means here? Can somebody tell us? It's Lakota, that's right. It's a white person. Do we know what the literal translation is? One who takes all the fat. That is correct. The greedy ones. I have a really funny story. One of my absolute closest friends, he's originally from Brooklyn. I was hanging out with him one time, and we were talking about Leonard's case and American Indian Movement Matters. And I said to him, I was like, you know, it's really interesting. You got to check this book out. Do you know this word, Wasichu? It doesn't even mean white person or white eye. It means the greedy ones, the ones who take everything and leave nothing for anyone else. And my friend, who just happens to be African American, leaned back and said, well, that describes y'all perfectly. So, and he's right. And when I told Leonard that, he got a good laugh out of that too. So if you haven't read this book, please do, because what I'm about to talk about and what a lot of us brothers and sisters in the Jericho movement, American Indian movement, what we're talking about, the mindset is explained very well in this book. Okay? So, before I continue, I just want to give you the most recent update. Lenny kind of filled you in. We were trying to get a transfer for Leonard, and we were trying to get him to transfer to the Wisconsin facility in for his... How do we say? I believe it was for the medical reasons, but he was denied. And the reason he was denied, from what I'm told, is because of his high classification as an inmate. Okay, we're talking about an elderly man with numerous health conditions who is in a wheelchair, but apparently he's classified as a high-profile inmate. I don't know what kind of danger the man could bring to the society as a high-profile inmate, air quote, but that allegedly is the reason why. And we are appealing that, and we're also looking down a couple of other legal avenues as well. So please do check the website, check our social media pages, because we do update that with regular updates on what's going on in the case and how you can help. Lenny brought up a great, great way you can help, because Leonard actually is a phenomenal artist. And if you check out the committee's website, there's a ton of great artwork on the website that you can buy. I stayed with Paulette down at the committee headquarters in Florida, and that's where a lot of the paintings are, so it was really cool to check that out. And it's an amazing way for us to raise the legal funds that it takes to be able to appeal the denials and the FOIA requests, because believe it or not, there's over 100,000 documents related to this case that still haven't been released. So did you have a question? Sure. Are you on the mailing list? I'm glad you asked, because we can get you right on there as soon as possible. Yes, there definitely was. There were social campaigns. There were letter writing campaigns. The thing is, a lot of it was posted on the website. If you received an email, I may be wrong, but I believe there was email sent out about a letter writing campaign. You can join the mailing list if you just go to the website, which is whoisleonardpeltier.info, I believe, or is I? Yes, it still is? Okay. So you want to go there, and you can sign up on the mailing list there. You can follow us on Facebook, and if you'd like, you and I can speak, and you can be in touch with me, and I'd be happy to give you updates myself. I'm very accessible. I do not bite. I am a Muay Thai athlete outside of my work for Leonard. Trust me, that won't play a factor here either. So I'm going to throw a couple of names out at you real quick. So I want to try to maybe enlighten you a little bit and talk to you about the case and maybe bring some things to light that maybe you didn't know about. How many people know about the name Myrtle Poorbear? You guys know who she is? Raise your hands. You guys know who Myrtle Poorbear is? No? Okay. Well, for those of you who do not know, Leonard Peltier was convicted originally for the first-degree murder of two special agents. Apparently, his conviction has changed since then to aiding and abetting. We can talk about that later. But he originally was found guilty of first-degree murder for the two FBI agents. He was in Canada fighting extradition to stand trial for this case. And there was a woman who magically appeared who claimed to be his girlfriend and claimed to witness the murders of the agents. She signed three affidavits. Each affidavit is different. The first affidavit states that she was his girlfriend but didn't see anything. The second affidavit says that she was there, but then she left before the agents died. And the third affidavit says that she not only witnessed it, but she gives a pretty vivid account of what happened to the agents. Did anyone here who's familiar with the story, did you know there's a fourth affidavit? Yep, there's a fourth affidavit. And in the fourth affidavit, she describes all of the torture and the abuse that she faced at the hands of the federal government. And they say knowledge is power. Knowledge truly is power, because I printed out 5 copies of it to circulate to everyone so you guys can read it. And please feel free to take it home if it winds up in your hands. I have copies, okay? So not only was she tortured, but I'll go you one better than that. The name of the prosecutor was Paul Halperin. I believe his name was Paul Halperin. His last name was Halperin. Paul Halperin was in the United States trying to gather all the information because Leonard was going to fight the extradition. And on February 10th, we found FBI documents that we've used in Leonard's appeals over the years that show that not only did he think there was enough evidence, he wasn't going to pursue Leonard for the extradition of the deaths of the agents. February 10th, 1976. There's another document on February 11th. Not only does it say that he wasn't going to pursue it, but that he was adamant about not pursuing the extradition because there just wasn't enough evidence. The date of the first affidavit, February 18th, 7 days later. Okay? So, you have a person who's fighting extradition for political reasons, and you have a government that's literally manufacturing evidence. And for those of you who don't know about what happened with Myrtle Poorbear when she got to trial and Leonard went to trial, she wasn't allowed to testify because that her testimony was going to shock the conscience of the court. I think it would, especially when you read this affidavit. I'll pass it out a little bit later. But another thing about the trial that I would like to highlight to you is, how many of you knew that Leonard Peltier's jury had a racist juror on it? Who said that? Say that again.
Just one.
I'll do you one better. How about this? Did you guys know that the judge was racist too? Absolutely true. In a few minutes, I'm going to show you this trailer that a colleague and dear friend of mine, Preston Randolph, he and I did this trailer together because we were doing a film for Leonard and we were trying to raise funds. So the only people that have seen it, to my knowledge, and Preston, if you're watching this, forgive me if I get this wrong, but my family, his family, Danny Glover, and Harry Belafonte. So you all and everyone here who's watching on the internet, you guys will be the first audience to see the actual trailer that we did. It's about 20 minutes long, and it does contain the audio of Leonard, portions of the audio of Leonard's sentencing statement when he was sentenced. But I want to get back to this judge. I'm glad I brought the film up, because in the course of the film is when I really did the bulk of my research and collected a large and vast amount of documents. I met Lenny Foster because of the research that I was doing at the time. And all this research helped me to get the position I have today with the committee because of the archive that I've collected. So I was scanning all of these appeals. As some of you know, how passionate we are about the work that we do. You're going through these appeals and, wow, look at this appeal and look at that appeal. I found a handwritten letter from Pedro Bissonnette. We know who Pedro Bissonnette is? Pedro Bissonnette, who was murdered by BIA and Goon Squad members in, I believe, 1974, if I'm not mistaken. He was an organizer for the Oglala Sioux Civil Rights Commission, and he was also a boxer before that. Okay, a phenomenal man, and to those of us who know the history, we'll always remember him. I found a handwritten letter by him, but also, when I was going through one of Leonard's appeals, I'm going through it, and I'm looking here, and they had this scanner. Just to give you an idea, you had to put the book on the platform, and you had to scan, turn. For hours, I was in the University of New Mexico, scanning and scanning. Now, unbeknownst to most of you, actually, I have a prosthetic left eye, so I only have one good eye, and the one good eye caught one little footnote that changed everything. And the footnote was, after Leonard Peltier's trial, there was an American Indian who stood before Judge Benson in his court and was found guilty, but had his guilty conviction overturned on the basis that it was found in sidebar conversations that Judge Benson had made racist remarks towards Indian people. So you have a racist juror, and you have a racist judge. From an historical perspective, can we say that that is justice? You have a racist judge and a racist juror. It's beyond bias. It's unfair and it's unjust. Now, I'm going to throw a couple more names at you, just so that we also understand the underlying tensions of why Leonard Peltier is in prison. Are you guys familiar with the name Norman Brown, Mike Anderson? You guys know? Well, I'm sure our friends here definitely know. Okay. Are you also familiar with Rich Draper, Angie Longvisitor? Okay, well, historically speaking, these are the four key witnesses, or they're labeled, quote unquote, the four key witnesses in Leonard's trial, 1977, Fargo, North Dakota. All four of these witnesses were tortured. I don't know if you guys are aware of that. Mike Anderson, under the age of 18, was subject to sleep deprivation and told that he wasn't allowed to be free unless he would testify against Leonard Peltier. Okay, Norman Brown was the only person under the age of 18 who had a relative that was over the age of 18 to be questioned. It's illegal, and it was illegal then. It's illegal now to question someone under the age of 18 without a parent or guardian or legal counsel. Mike Anderson and Wish Draper, both under the age of 18, did not have either, yet their testimony was allowed. Okay. They were boys. Norman Brown's mother, who was present, though, was told that if he did not testify, she would never see her son again alive. Wish Draper, who was another one of the four defendants, he was put in front of interrogators and was facing the most egregious jail sentence for having an open container of alcohol, because when they arrested him or when they apprehended him, I believe he was drinking at the time. Okay? Angie Longvisitor is the one that makes me the most sad, because she and Ivis Longvisitor were subject to long prison sentences because they would not testify against Leonard. She was tortured. She was told she would never see her children again. And when she refused to testify, they put her back in jail. Now, one of the very interesting things that I found as a researcher at the Fargo Federal Courthouse archive that they have for Leonard's trial is a handwritten letter, and it's right up here. It's a little hard to see. I can pull it up maybe. Let's see, zoom in a little. Oh no, computers. But this is Angie's signature. It's a scan of the letter because the letter was handwritten, and it's co-signed by her lawyer, Kenneth Tilson. If anyone's familiar with the history, Ken Tilson's a monumental attorney for the Wounded Knee Defense Committee. And in the letter, she outlines all the torture that she was subjected to, okay? So we're talking torturing of witnesses, okay? A huge factor in the case. And when you're tortured, you'll say anything, you know? And who can blame the young children, okay? More than half of which did not have an adult or legal counsel when they were questioned, okay? Also, something that I wanted to bring up. There were other witnesses that were tortured as well. For example, David Little. David Little was a witness who was subject to torture that was so grave that it affects him to this day. He was the first person that was arrested and apprehended and sought to be a suspect in the Resmers case, which is the acronym Reservation Murders. That's Leonard's case within the FBI. Okay. David Sky was subject to such grave torture that the attorney that went in to go visit with him when they arranged to have legal counsel for him after he had been apprehended said that he had been so brutally tortured that he hasn't been the same since to this day. And his brother, Bo passed away a couple years ago. He told me in an interview that his brother never recovered from that. To this day, I'm not sure if David is still living, but to this day, I'm told by his family that he still feels that those effects. So a lot of people in this case were tortured, okay? A lot of people, and that's why Leonard Peltier is in prison. Another story I kind of want to relate to you now is a story that Ramsey Clark told me. Ramsey Clark, I'm sure we're all familiar with Ramsey. Ramsey Clark? No, come on, let's applaud for Ramsey Clark. Ramsey Clark's a warrior. Straight up, Ramsey Clark is a warrior. Ramsey Clark was Leonard Peltier's attorney for one of his full parole hearings. I believe it was in the 90s. And when I called Ramsey, when we were doing the research for the film that the trailer you're going to see, Ramsey told me, he said, well, you know, have you heard the famous parole story? And I said, don't, please tell me. And he said, well, you know, I was Leonard's lawyer. I was Leonard's lawyer for his parole hearing, and we went in. We did the whole, as Mike Kuzma says, the dog and pony show. Okay. So he went in, they did the show, and of course, any of us who are familiar with parole hearings, they make you, sometimes they give you a decision, sometimes they make you wait. I believe Leonard Peltier, they've never given a fast decision unless it's a quick denial. But they usually wait for that too, because they really do love to torture the man. Okay, and that's a sad commentary. But anyway, Ramsey did his best. They went in, did the parole hearing. A couple weeks went by, they got the denial. And then several months, I believe, afterwards, Ramsey himself happened to be going to a federal prison, unrelated to Leonard, just going to a prison to do whatever work he had to do. And when he got to the prison, he was confronted by a prison guard and said, "Oh, how you doing, Mr. Clark? It's nice to see you." And he didn't recognize the guy. And he said, "Oh, do I know you?" And the guard said, "Oh, yeah, you don't remember me? I was the parole hearing officer, examiner, excuse me, not officer, examiner. I was the parole examiner for Leonard Peltier." And he said, "Oh, you were?" And he said, "Oh, yeah, you don't know?" And he said, "Don't know what?" "I recommended Leonard for parole. Then I was demoted." Okay? That's what's happening with Leonard Peltier. Leonard Peltier is in jail for political reasons. Truth. Absolutely true. Okay? Now, I could go on and on about all dozens of witnesses. I just want to let you all know that I'm very accessible. I would love to speak with any of you. I'm sure we're going to exchange some great contact information if you want to stay in touch. But one thing that we could definitely use is if you could donate some funds to the legal fund or to the committee, because we got a lot of appeals on the horizon and a lot of exciting things that we're trying to do for Leonard and for everyone. So please do keep a check on us. Check our website. Check social media. I absolutely hate social media, but apparently it's great and it can bring us together. So the one great thing about social media is that we can unite and that we can work together and we can be a movement. Okay? Great. So before we show the world premiere of The Wind Chases the Sun trailer, let me just see if there's anything else I'd like to bring up, because I know we're on a time constraint. Oh, there is one other thing. Again, this book, Wasichu, if you haven't checked it out, please do. You can get it on Amazon, okay? It's an older book, okay? But we are actually, Leonard and I are trying to get this made into an audiobook. I work for an audiobook publisher full-time, so I'm trying to do that as well. But there is also an audiobook coming for this book here, Sandra's Hands. Okay, it's written by a guy by the name of Paul Berg. And look, the foreword is written by a nice, young, charming man by the name of Dan Battaglia, myself. Sandra's Hands is a book by a gentleman. His name is Paul Berg. Paul Berg was a mission teacher on Pine Ridge Indian Reservation, and he actually had just left the Vietnam War in the Navy and took a job on the res during the Reign of Terror. And this is a memoir of his experience. And the big part of the book is Sandra Wounded Foot. God bless her. I have a picture of it at my desk. 14-year-old Lakota young lady who was raped, accosted, and murdered by a BIA officer in, I believe it was 1976. So, but before we put the trailer on, it's an outstanding book, and I'm not just saying that because I helped, but it is a really good book, and I highly recommend it. Does anyone have any questions about Leonard, about the case, about anything that you'd like to ask? Okay, we're going to do that later. Sorry. Anyhow, we're going to take questions later. I'm happy to answer any questions up here, wherever. No problem. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, please enjoy the world premiere of The Wind Chases the Sun pitch trailer. Would it be possible to turn the lights down?
to review all the remaining executive clemency applications. I will try to do what I think the right thing to do is based on the evidence. I'll decide one way or the other.
There was a rare display of power in Washington today. Hundreds of FBI agents marching on the White House.
I must say it's very frightening when I see government officials, armed officials, marching through the streets of our Capitol to convince a civilian president not to correct the civil rights abuses that they themselves have committed.
My fellow citizens, tonight is my last opportunity to speak to you from the Oval Office as your president.
The final ticks of the Clinton presidency passed. Pardons granted to former members of Congress, drug traffickers, and billionaire fugitives. But there was one case the Clinton administration did not address.
He's an American Indian named Leonard Peltier. The FBI has long been determined that he will never go free.
Why would an agency continue to prosecute a man they imprisoned three decades earlier? Was it vengeance, or was it something much more, spanning 40 years? The 70s began with an earthquake of reform. The fires of social change and civil rights intensified as support for the Vietnam War hit an all-time low. Youth movements demanding redress in policies were considered subversive and immediate threats to national security.
President Johnson let it be known that the FBI is closely watching all anti-war activity.
Peaceful protests were spurred by police brutality, and activists were simply gunned down. During this age of turmoil, a new movement was born, a movement dedicated to ratifying treaty rights and assuring that equality was more than just another broken promise. In their eyes, their people had suffered long enough.
When the American Indian Movement came, it gave our people that strength to go on.
And we went to Washington, D.C. and demanded that it be a federal crime to kill Indian people. And they said no.
Back in the 70s, the American Indian Movement was regarded as a terrorist organization by the United States. The FBI considered the American Indian Movement to be one of the most dangerous organizations in the country. And in the documents, what they put down was a whole list of very lawful activities. Concerns about civil rights, jobs, housing, justice, etc. But then they noted that AIM was shifting its emphasis towards protecting the earth and to stopping destructive mining operations.
America's energy demands have grown so rapidly that they now outstrip our energy supplies. What is needed now is decisive and responsible action to increase our energy supplies.
The dozens of companies involved in the billion-dollar mining operations of the Black Hills immediately felt the threat of the American Indian Movement. The departments of Interior and Justice would intervene.
We have declared Wounded Knee an independent country and the corporate state for the Oak Island Nation.
A 71-day siege at Wounded Knee on the most poverty-stricken community in the United States would generate exposure, but also infuriate the powers it questioned.
Dick Wilson set out to eliminate the presence of the American Indian Movement on the Pine Ridge Reservation.
Is it really you against AIM, Mr. Wilson?
I think it is, yes.
But you have been accused, of course, that in your interest in law and order, you have in fact taken the law into your own hand.
Sometimes we find that necessary.
This goal seemed to coincide with the Federal Bureau of Investigation's goal to eliminate civil rights movements in the country, and especially the civil rights movement among Native Americans.
When you are out there to help protect the land, or even to initiate to help the people, you are a target. You are not worth a doggone anything to the government, so you're disposable.
With the law on his side, Wilson employed a vigilante police force to inhabit the reservation and control those who didn't agree with his policies.
I was one of Dick Wilson's right-hand people. So he was a leader, but if he said, get this done, people knew that they better get it done or they would get fired, I mean, on the spot.
They literally created a climate of terror They killed as many as people as they could and prosecuted as many people as they could.
The ongoing beatings, harassment, and murders of traditional people escalated without any repercussions from federal law enforcement.
You see somebody getting beat up or jumped, someone gets their house fired upon, the BIA cops never come. They never come.
The FBI tolerated and to a certain degree actively supported the destruction of indigenous people through third-party vigilantes, and if I may call them, death squads, because there were people who were killed, including a close friend of mine, including one of my students, killed by a federal agent. It is hard to believe that something like this could happen in the United States. It's difficult for me to accept even to this day.
They're being slaughtered, beaten, and killed every day. Don't you have any answers?
There was fear and a feeling that something was about to happen.
Several people warned the FBI that their own people were going to be killed, but this warning was ignored.
There are shots in the distance. This is the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation near Oglala.
According to still sketchy and unconfirmed reports, two FBI agents were killed while trying to serve arrest warrants on Indians at the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation in South Dakota.
When we heard that there were federal agents that were killed, this was one of the worst fears that we had, that this would happen, because we knew at that point all hell was going to break loose on the reservation. The people would suffer more than ever. Nobody cared very much if a Native American was killed. That was not that big a deal. But you kill somebody from the dominant society, especially somebody who holds a federal badge, and all hell was going to break loose.
Violence begets violence. And I earnestly hope that the subjects responsible for the deaths of these two fine young men surrender. We have no mission of retribution.
The FBI embarked on one of the largest criminal investigations in their history, determined to find the killers of Special Agents Ronald Williams and Jack Kohler. The murder of Joe Stuntz was simply ignored.
You had three men who were shot in the head and killed. Why is an Indian's life worth any less than agents?
The FBI says it's looking for 16 persons in connection with yesterday's fatal shooting on South Dakota's Pine Ridge Indian Reservation.
The rage of the FBI escalated in the weeks following. Over 200 agents infiltrated the reservation.
They would be looking for certain people. They were asking kids, I'll give you a dollar if you tell me where so-and-so lives.
People's houses were ransacked. There was no pretense of having a search warrant. They went through people's houses looking for things, breaking things. There was a lot of anger and, again, more palpable fear on the reservation, but this time fear directly of federal marshals and FBI agents.
You would think that they were very, no sides, just to see that the laws are in place and also justified. But there never was. These guys were always the bullies.
The Oglalas don't like what happened. And if the FBI don't get them, the Oglalas will.
What do you mean?
Just what I said. We have our own way of punishing people that way.
Shooting on the reservation?
You said it. We'll take care of them.
Without compelling evidence, the FBI had already decided to lock Leonard Peltier into the case. Weeks later, he was then indicted for murder alongside Dino Butler, Bob Robideau, and Jimmy Eagle. In February 1976, Leonard Peltier is captured in Vancouver, Canada, where he decides to fight extradition in fear of an unfair trial in the United States. Dino Butler and Bob Robideau were arrested and tried in Cedar Rapids, Iowa. Evidence exposing FBI misconduct and their abuse of power on the reservation was admissible during the hearings. The jury was able to deliberate based on the facts of the case, but also on an understanding of the tensions on the reservation leading up to the agents' deaths. That admission would infuriate the FBI.
In Cedar Rapids, Iowa today, a federal jury acquitted two members of the American Indian Movement.
A cheer went up in the courtroom and the defendants embraced their attorneys.
The FBI felt that it was the judge's fault that there were acquittals. And it was the judge's fault because he allowed in evidence that the FBI didn't want. The government wasn't going to let that happen in the Peltier trial. And they didn't.
A meeting in Washington, D.C. was held with FBI officials to determine what went wrong in the Butler-Robideau trial and to assure that this would never happen again. Charges immediately were dropped against Jimmy Eagle, so the full prosecutive weight of the federal government could be placed against Leonard Peltier. In December, Peltier was extradited back to the United States based on affidavits signed by a Myrtle Poorbear claiming that Peltier had confessed to her. Months later, these very affidavits were proven fabricated and signed by Poorbear as she was held against her will and threatened by the FBI.
He said, we're going to use you next in this guy's trial. And you remember, they said, if you pull anything, then we're going to kill you.
Just before Peltier's trial was scheduled to begin, the government demanded a venue change to Fargo, North Dakota, where FBI-friendly judge Paul Benson resided. The trial opened with an all-white sequestered jury. From the start, rulings from the bench strongly favored the government. Myrtle Poorbear was not allowed to testify, and the affidavits used to extradite Peltier were suddenly determined to be not relevant. Crucial evidence exposing the tensions and FBI misconduct on the reservation were withheld from the jury. In the midst of the trial, a new affidavit was presented to Judge Benson. A jury member had expressed extreme racism toward American Indians, and those close to her felt that she would be unable to put those racist feelings aside. In a closed-door hearing, Judge Benson decided to let the trial continue.
I remember repeatedly, yet by the end of the day, feeling fairly depressed about what was going on. We were getting terrible rulings from the judge. He was letting the government do whatever basically they wanted to.
Just based on the sheer volume of documents that weren't provided to Leonard Peltier's defense attorneys, how can you say he had a fair trial? How could his defense attorneys prepare an adequate defense in light of the fact that thousands and thousands of pages were withheld in 1977 and continue to be withheld?
Defense in the Butler-Robideau case took about 2.5 weeks. In Peltier's case, we were only allowed about a half a day. You know, it just seemed like there was such a railroad that was going on towards conviction, and the feelings of being powerless.
Despite the hundreds of cartridge casings found in the area of the crime scene, the prosecution concentrated on just one. It was fired from an AR-15 rifle they linked to Peltier. The jury went to deliberation with no understanding of the violent tensions between natives and the federal government or the illegal actions by the FBI in Indian country.
Judge Benson, there is no doubt in my mind or my people's you are going to sentence me to 2 consecutive life terms. You have openly favored the government all through this trial, and you are happy to do whatever the FBI would want you to do in this case. This does not surprise me, because you are a high-ranking member of the white racist American establishment, which has consistently said, in God we trust, while they went about the business of murdering my people and attempting to destroy our culture. The only thing I'm guilty of, in which I was convicted for, was of being Chippewa and Sioux blood.
It's my car, Nora girl. Running from the law in a smoking gun. There are stolen boots, 2 white men dead. And I made the list of the most wanted.
But clearly, throughout this trial, there has been a consistent
failure by the court to allow into evidence things which are permitted under the federal rules of evidence.
There was not a single Native American on the jury or among the prospective jurors. Judge Benson misused his power by suppressing important evidence of FBI threats to witnesses and of FBI perjury, and by admitting as evidence fabrications by the FBI.
Since February 6th of 1976, Leonard Peltier has been wrongfully imprisoned. And no matter how many times it's shown testimony was fabricated, physical evidence was fabricated, the response is, well, so what?
Years after Peltier's conviction, a key piece of documentation was discovered through the Freedom of Information Act. This document, previously withheld from the defense, proved that the cartridge casing found near the agents' bodies did not, in fact, match the rifle affiliated with Peltier. The most important aspect of the government's prosecution was debunked.
So here you had previously suppressed ballistics evidence that showed that Peltier didn't do it. And so even if you can then prove that the government fabricated a case against you and targeted you politically, you can't get a new trial. It's terrifying.
The government was allowed to switch its conviction from first-degree murder to aiding and abetting. Now, 36 years after his conviction, Peltier remains in federal prison.
Leonard is treated differently in prison than other inmates, and he is harassed. The FBI is the hierarchy in the prison system. They have one or two agents assigned, and they do call the shots.
His treatment through the Bureau of Prisons is an ongoing harassment, and the agenda against him is just as strong today as it was 30 years ago.
There are forces that want him removed from the face of the earth and will not stop until they attempt to do so.
It's pretty obvious there is an agenda out there to get Leonard and to persecute him every chance you can get, because he's taking it, but he's getting older. He needs some help.
Peltier for decades has been denied adequate medical care. But now, as his health declines, his life is in the balance.
If we are to have a democracy, if we are to have a justice system that really is about justice, then we really need to look at these cases. It is in extraordinary cases, like the Peltier case, that we lose our rights.
There was a time when we believed in our government. We had faith that justice would prevail, and our Constitution would be followed and defended by those we elect. But decades ago, this dream was lost in the offices of the White House and the halls of the FBI. We now live in an age where the very individuals who advocate illegal operations against civil rights movements stay in power for decades and enforce those same policies against the movements of today. We may dream of change and hope that justice exists, but as long as an innocent man languishes in the jails of the United States, it will all be just a myth.
I'm innocent. And I've been fighting for my people's rights since I was a young man, teenager. And no matter what happens to me, if I die, even if I have to die here, I will continue fighting for my people's rights.
Well, that's the, no, it's working now. That was great, fantastic.
Did you like it?
Yeah, fantastic. Yeah.
A few minutes? Is that okay? Okay. You guys thought it was good? Just if you hold your hands, listen, I just want to say, Preston, wherever you are, we work too hard for that not to be seen.
That's right.
So I hope you all enjoy it, and let's spread it, because to use Preston's words, if anything can help, put it out there. So I just wanted to follow up on one thing, actually two things. We mentioned in there that the trial venue was changed. That was done without a court order, and that's illegal. Ed McManus, Judge McManus, who was the trial judge for Dino and Bob in their trial, who were indicted with Leonard. He just recently passed away and was a federal judge till his dying day. He was appointed by John F. Kennedy, President Kennedy. And I was trying to get an interview with him, but I didn't. And obviously now it's not going to happen. But he said in a previous interview that I have that on his docket was Leonard's trial. He was supposed to try Leonard Peltier. He was originally going to try Leonard, Bob, and Dino and held out as long as he could. So if that would have happened, I think Leonard would be with us today and he wouldn't be in jail. But there's one thing that I would like to do, if you all will indulge me, because the film, if you will, Preston and I labored over that film for years. And we worked very hard on trying to do all that we can. We still work for Leonard. I do, and Preston does as well. That's sort of our prayer for Leonard, if you will. But there was a name brought up by our brother and our leader, Lenny. His name is Ray Manuel Thunder. And there's a lot of other names that are lost to history that don't get brought up. Names like Wesley Badheart Bull, Sandra Wounded Foot, the Dull Knife family, the Janices, a lot of people who were affected in this time and stood up for what they believed in no matter what. Gladys Bissonette, okay? And if we could all just take a moment to stand and give a moment of silence to recognize their sacrifice and Lenny's sacrifice and the entire movement's sacrifice for standing up for what was right. Because if you don't stand up for something, you'll fall for anything. Always in our hearts. All power to the people. Thank you very much. Yeah, sure. Oh, and I'm going to pass around some things that I brought, the racist juror affidavit, the scan of it. We'll pass it out. You guys can take a look. And the murder poor bear affidavit. Thank you very much again.
Thank you. That was great. Thank you. Especially that video is fantastic and has a lot of good information. Okay. Yeah, I know. I have to talk with him to see. Is he ready? Or? He's over there behind this guy. He's talking to the tech guy. All right, so that was really good because we have some very interesting information here. And, you know, this is not an aberration when you hear about, you know, the U.S. government torturing witnesses and so on and so forth. This is not an aberration. This happens in many, many cases. In Mumia Abu-Jamal's case, witnesses were tortured and coerced, and he is another innocent man who is sitting in prison for a crime he did not commit. In the case of the Omaha 2, and one of them is still alive, 48 years in prison, classic COINTELPRO case, where people were also tortured and coerced. And that's Ed Poindexter, who is totally innocent, and his co-defendant, Mondo Elanga, died in prison. Two completely innocent people. In the case of the San Francisco 8, people who were tortured in the 70s in New Orleans had the people who tortured them show up to give them their search warrants and affidavits. They had to come and testify and subpoenas. The people who tortured them. So this is not an aberration, folk. This is a reality of the so-called United States of America. And every person in this room, I am sure, and certainly every person of color, knows that there is no equality in this country. So, you know, we're going to talk a little bit about some other political prisoners, just because their cases are so similar. We were down in Philly yesterday for Mumia Abu-Jamal. He just turned 65 years old on April 24th. There has been some movement finally after many, many years in his case. Judge Leon Tucker has opened the door for all of Mumia's appeals that were denied from 1996 until 2012. There's all kinds of prosecutorial and judicial misconduct involved in there. Judge Sabo was known as a prosecutor in robes. That was the original judge in Mumia's trial. He said, I am going to help them fry the N-word. He was heard saying that by a court stenographer. So That is the kind of stuff that our political prisoners have to deal with every day, right? And as a Native person, Leonard had to deal with even more than most of us do, because there has been a campaign of genocide against Native peoples since the first European white settler put their foot on this land. And that has been going on ever since. You know, the murders and the tortures right now, there's a whole thing with Native women being disappeared all over the place, which Lenny mentioned. This is a huge, huge problem. And people do not know about it because the so-called media doesn't tell us. And it's done in places that are not, you know, it's not in the middle of the city if you're out on the res. You know, you're in the middle of nowhere. So they can do all kinds of things. And, you know, they do. So, you know, Mumia finally has got an open door. The DA in Philly was going to appeal this decision, the so-called progressive DA, Krasner. And the movement beat that back. He's dropped that appeal, which means that now we can finally, after all these years, 37 years, go forward with Mumia's appeals. And we are very happy to have that happen. And I also want to tell people, we do free political prisoners, all right? A year ago yesterday, our brother Herman Bell walked out the door. He walked out the door after 45 years in prison on a 25 to life. And I just got to see Herman last night, and it was really great to be able to spend a little time with him. But this is the kind of injustice that people face every day in this system. If you are sentenced to 25 to life, and you complete your minimum 25, and you have not committed any infractions, and you have completed all your programs, it is presumed that you will be released. Howsomever, if you are a quote-unquote cop killer, whether you did that or not, you are going to pay a different price, because this is how this government criminalizes freedom fighters, by throwing that word at them. They did that to Leonard. Leonard didn't kill those FBI agents, and the whole world knows that he didn't do it. And there's another video of Leonard on 60 Minutes many years ago when Mike Wallace asked him, well, since you actually know who did it, why don't you just say so you can walk out the door? And Leonard said, I'm no snitch. I'm no snitch. That's principle. That's principle. All right? He knows who did that. He's not going to tell who did that. Would you tell if you knew somebody that you knew who had done something for your people? I wouldn't tell. Unless they tortured me, then I can't say. Right? So, you know, so when they use torture, that's not an aberration. There's plenty of people who have been tortured. Right? Now, we also have some people here in New York State. Our brother Jaleel Muntakim, who Lenny mentioned, because he just saw him yesterday for the second visit, because he met him last year. He has got a little campaign going, requesting commutation of sentence to time served to Governor Cuomo. It was in with your programs. It's a blue sheet. Gives a little detail of his case and who he is. He's going to be 68 years old in October. He's done 48 years in prison on a 25 to life. If you even assume that the crime was committed, he should have been released in 2002. All right? So he's asking people to call and write the governor. You have the written information. There's more on our literature table. But, you know, there's a lot of stuff going on with all our political prisoners. The Virgin Islands Three are suddenly going to be moved from Tutwiler, Mississippi, where they're in a private prison, to somewhere in Florida. We don't know exactly where yet. We're trying to find out. There are some brothers who have been down for 46 plus years, have medical problems like you would not believe, and need to be home in the Virgin Islands. When they were in prison in the Virgin Islands, they could walk around. They were out on the street. You know, the COs brought one of them to the masjid so he could pray and then forgot to pick them up. So obviously they ain't no danger to the community. So, you know, what is the excuse? What is the excuse? You know, there is no excuse. The only reason people are sitting behind these walls is because they are freedom fighters and they fought for all of us. Every single one of us. People were fighting to better their communities, the same fights we're doing today. Housing, education, medical care, out here in the streets. The same fights are the same fights people were doing back then. Food, exactly. Food. There are a lot of people who don't have enough to eat in this country, and we know that's true, you know? So I wanted Ben, to come up too, because he wanted us to talk about Nina and Annabelle and Montes, two of the current Puerto Rican political prisoners, just to be brief, and then we'll have, hopefully, Spirit Child.
Okay, brothers and sisters, like Ann said briefly, we have two Puerto Rican political prisoners in U.S. jails right now. Ana Belén Montes, who's been in jail for 17 years because she chose to protect Cuba's right to self-determination and autonomy. We have Nina Dros Franco, a sister who this May 1st on Wednesday will be not celebrating, but will be have been in jail for 2 years. Ana Belén Montes, 62 years old, is dealing still with breast cancer. She's receiving the minimal amount of medical care that they can possibly give her. Nina Dros is the one that's actually in a current crisis. Her mother has been putting out a special call for us to send letters to the warden of her prison. You can go to prolibertad.org for all that information. Nina has serious back issues that she developed before she went to jail. She's been denied her medicine. She's in constant pain. She has four herniated discs and a couple of other back issues. So the sister right now is in crisis. Her mother's making a public call that we are supporting. You can get all of that information on prolibertad.org. Once again, prolibertad.org, or you can visit JerichoNewYork.com and find the applicable links. Brothers and sisters, when I say freedom, you say now. Freedom?
Yeah.
Freedom?
Yeah.
Freedom?
Yeah.
Thank you, brothers and sisters.
I know Spirit Child is back there having a coffee or something. Spirit Child, are you ready? We changed the program around a little bit because Spirit Child was, you know, he's had family too, young children, and he was coming from Rikers Island where he does work with the prisoners, which we think is incredible. And we're very happy to have him with us to give us some of his uplifting, beautiful spoken words for Leonard and for all of us, and to, you know, uplift our spirits because we need to have them uplifted. But let's remember, we do free political prisoners, and we have some of them home this year in New York State and in Pennsylvania. We have Herman Bell, Robert Seth Hayes, Maliki Shakur Lateen, and Debbie and Mike Africa of the Move family in Pennsylvania. So in one year, we got four political prisoners out the door. And believe me, that is not an easy thing to do. So we are on roll, as we say. We might be fighting against the tide, but we're going to bring them all home. That is our promise. That is a promise I personally made to Safia Bukhari in 1998. She's no longer with us, but I will keep that promise to Safia, and if I have to die doing it, I will die doing it. But my brothers and sisters are coming home, and then we're going to change this system because we have had more than enough of this nonsense.
Thank you. Right on. So when you can play whenever, yeah. So peace, people. How you doing? Good. Peace. I'm not sure where my family is. What they supposed to be coming? They coming through. You can play whenever, and then we'll just get some. Yeah. All right. Good. So if you're feeling, you know, we like to do resistance music, and everything is all good, full of vibration. It's Sunday, right? So we're gonna pretend like it's Friday night. Saturday night, keep the vibrations going. Like, we got all our political prisoners home free right now. We're gonna keep that energy. Gotta bounce to my protest. I bounce my step. Resist with the funk I possess. Hey, stop it. You're doing it wrong if you can't move along. Like moveon.org, I'm involved with the strong. Free Mumia Abu Jamal. And since it's my song, political prisoners, freedom all. Let's get it, y'all. That freedom, taste it. Big sweat to your back like a bashment. Party in the basement, it's basic, I want it, you got it, so give it up. That passion, make it happen, who's asking to give a fuck? I do more like making love to freedom till she come. I'm a bus, loaded gun with the funk, yeah. Reload,
Reload. Reload. Expose yourself. So let go. Let go. Party people, let go. Peace. Let go. Let go. Now, now, now. Free yourself. Get up off those chains. Got to take them away. Get up off those chains. Yep, yep. Gotta bounce on my protest, the goo to my step. Resist what the funk I possess. Let's get it popping. Moving along like tools and pop songs. Like moving along, sock folks. I'm involved with the strong again. Free Mumia Abu Jamal. And since it's my song, political prisoners, freedom all. Let's get it, y'all. That freedom, taste it. Bring sweat to your back like a bashment. Party in the basement. So FBI and CIA got no place in our COINTEL, that be they, but we be the people when we be free till each and every one of us in the streets now. Basic, I want it, you got it, so give it up. That passion, make it happen, who's asking to give a fuck? I do more like making love to freedom till she come. I'm a busloaded gun with the funk. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Reload.
There you go, see?
Reload. Hey. Hey, reload, expose yourself. Come on, come on, yep. Let go, let go, let go, let go, let go. And now free yourself. Get up off those chains, break them, gossipy your way. Break them, get it broke those chains. Yep, yep, we free to fly, fly. Yes,
thank you. Thank you. So I'll do a few more, and we on Rikers Island work with the young people. I'll talk about in a second.
We so broke, we on dope, we acid, classic advancing. Like when we get for books, advancing, paxing. So we can bring it back to flaxing. You know how it is, resisting, we still relaxing. Never relaxing in the shade, we do it for us, we do it for Mamiya, we do it for us. Russell Maroon Schultz, we still fighting the balls. You know how it is till we break them. Freedom all, we still adhere to the call. And our political prisoners, each and every one of them, we still within ya. And we got you in our minds, heart, body, and soul. That's how it is. It'll never control us. So resist and we organize, we rebel. And you feel the fire, we react. Bring the fire, we react. And we bring the fire, we resist, organize, rebel, bell, feel the fire, react, act, prepare to ride, retell, write them rhymes, resist, get free, organize, rebel, be free, feel the fire, react, let's up, prepare to ride, retell. Funny story, on my last flight, I stopped in Toronto, I paused. Keep your composure, tighten up your jaw, cause you know how I be, like, fuck the law. But anyway, they say, you ever been denied before? Entry to Canada, you gotta stop 44, what? Yeah, 3 years ago in Montreal, Border Patrol said, what you coming here for? Look me up on my tour page. I think he even played the track. Came back, said Palestine, and that was that IDF train. He probably worked for the Mossad, but I work for a higher force. So fuck your law. Again, take a checkpoint, supporters, and find yourself. Resist, organize, rebel, bell, feel the fire, react, act, prepare to ride, retell. Write them rhymes, resist, get free, organize, rebel, bell, feel the fire, react, prepare to ride, retell, write them rhymes, resist, yeah, organize, rebel, bell, feel the fire, react, act, prepare to ride, retell, write them rhymes, resist, yeah, organize, rebel, bell, feel the fire, react. Yes, prepare to ride, retell. Write them rhymes, 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 rhymes. Yes. You can forward that one, please. There's one song I wanted to do. Maybe it's this one. No, not that one. Nope, not that one. The next one? Not that one yet. That one, yes. Pause that for a second. Yeah. Okay, cool. So this song I wrote for our young people. We've been doing some pretty important work for the past few years. So if some of y'all haven't seen me for a while, it's mostly growing babies. And the other part is working on Rikers and at Sing Sing, doing a lot of music programming. So yes, yes, yes. So somehow, crazily enough, they let some of us in to do the work that we do. unbeknownst to what they know we're supposed to be doing, we're doing hip-hop music, right? So within our hip-hop music, we're talking about Maroons, and this is some of the stuff that we bring in, Maroon comics, so we have that. And this is some music that of young people I worked on in Europe. So we're doing a summer camp this summer for Hip Hop and Social Justice. It's our 8th annual summer camp. And many people in our community have come and given workshops. So if you want to support, you can buy some of their music, and that'll go towards the programming. So this is like hip hop from Germany, the Netherlands. Where's the other places? There's some Amsterdam there. Yeah, Amsterdam, Rotterdam. And not Switzerland. We haven't worked with Switzerland yet. But you get the idea. We're trying to make this kind of a global movement. We're going back out. And this year, we're dedicating our summer camp in Iceland and our summer camp in New York City to Nicholas Hayward. If y'all know who Nicholas Hayward is, we want to keep the spirit alive for his son and for him. And through his legacy, every year he's allowed us to bring our young people to perform at the Nicholas Hayward commemoration in Gowanus. So we want to keep that up. We hope to see y'all there again this summer. There's a basketball tournament, there's food, there's culture, there's hip-hop music. We try to tie this all together, you know, from whether you're fighting against police brutality or trying to bring your political prisoners home or for Mother Earth, indigenous peoples. It's all one struggle, and this is what we try to bring through the music. So please, DJ Selector, yes, for Maroons everywhere worldwide, until we escape, run away, or just find a way to vibe. So I like this song from Gyptian, right? Like, you know, but I didn't like the lyrics so much. I was like, let me try to remix it. So I kind of vibe with it a little bit. So just vibe. Don't you feel like you about to give the system the tightest fight it ever to see in its life? Revolution and need ya. Don't be slave for the media. Lock and load and control on for the science soul of this mic. Well, all right. Make a man them a feel like a maroon, maroon. Woman them a feel like a maroon, maroon. Youth them a feel like a maroon, maroon. Block not kill a block when a business of Kuno. Them out of control with the media lies it's unfold. Well, if you're a bad man, then I work your plan. Fight the system with all of your soul. Evolution unfold, yeah. Don't you feel like you're bored? Give the system the tightest fight it ever did see in its life. Revolution on media. Don't be slave for the media. Lock and load and control on for the science soul that is mine. They try and tell me I ain't fit for that. They schools, they rules, I ain't fit for that. That's true, I'm a rune, not aristocrat. I ain't a coon, I'm a rune, there's no fixing that. Nah, leave the plantation, I'm not a problem. I'm a solution like the Haitian Revolution singing. Sac passe, ma boule, set fire to the oppressor, Lord La Roule. I see the media teach. Well, I'ma tie your tools to the youth them can't reach. Better yet, we train youth to think so they can see what you pour and choose not to drink. It's life is but a blink. But what matters, my sacrifice? Rocks I sling, pure rocks I sling, like slingshot hip-hop, rocks to them slave camps, freedom from prison. And I ain't talking about that whack dope. I'm talking about a new black arts movement in stereo. Left, right, discipline, the scenario. Wake them up, Harlem, giving the bum-bum. BX of Brooklyn, giving the bum-bum. Queens on deck, my Southeast Asians. A new wool coming through, island of Staten. Let it spread, don't trust the system. Let it spread, don't trust the system. Whatever they want, you give them none twice. Let it spread, don't trust the system. Whatever they want, revolution unfold, yeah. Don't you feel like you're voter? Give the system the tightest fight it ever to see in its life. Revolution on media. Don't be slave for the media. Lock and load and control on for the science soul of this mic. Well, all right, make a man them a feel like a maroon, maroon. Woman them a feel like a maroon, maroon. Youth them a feel like a maroon, maroon. Black not kill black when a business with Kuna. Them out of control, with the media lies it's unfold. Well, if you're a bad man, then I work your pun. Fight the system with all of your soul, revolution unfold, yeah. Don't you feel like you're bota? Give the system the tightest fight it ever did see in its life. Revolution on media. Don't be slave to the media. Lock and load and control and for the science soul of this mic. We all a sack passe, mag boule, sack passe, mag boule, we say sack passe, mag boule, we say sack passe, mag boule, we say lead beta, lead beta, we all a lead beta, lead beta, we want lead beta, lead beta, we all a lead beta, yeah, yeah, we say freedom, freedom, we want freedom. Freedom, we want freedom. Freedom, we want freedom. Leonard Peltier, with me, Abu Jamal, all of our political prisoners have been too long. Thank you so much, party people. I appreciate you. And I love you.
Thank you. That was beautiful and uplifting, right? I would say, hey, what's the call? Free them all. What's the call? All right, we're going to do that. We got a couple of brief announcements, and then Lenny is going to lead us in the AIM song to close. There is an event in solidarity with the independence of Puerto Rico, which is a very important struggle, as we all know. Puerto Rico is not part of the United States. It is an independent, sovereign country. All right? Yeah, so on June 22nd, right here at the People's Forum at 6 p.m., we're going to have this wonderful fourth annual Day of Solidarity with the Independence of Puerto Rico and celebrate and pay tribute to freedom fighter, patriot, Lolita Lebron, who we all love and know. So that will be happening. Frankie has the cards, English and Spanish. Make sure you leave some here too, Frankie. And so get them from Frankie and remember to come out for this event. And our brother Shep here, one of the original members of the Black Panther Party, has an announcement to make, and then we will conclude.
What's the call? What's the call? Right on. How many people here are part of an organization? Let me see your hands, if you're part of an organization. Okay, how many are not part of an organization? Okay, you need to start one or be part of one, all right? I'm putting that out and be real short with this. In 2021, anybody hear me? 2021, right here in New York City, is going to be a historic tribunal that's going to take place to deal with all of our political prisoners. So I want you all to make sure you get one of these green trifolds. Everybody see this? I want you to read what's inside. It was written by one of our prisoners right now, Brother Jaleel Montekin, who Lenny talked about, all right? There's a statement inside of here that's asking you to support what's going to take place here in New York City in 2021. I want you to read that, and then after you read it, everybody hear me? After you read it, I want you to look on the back. And if your organization is not on the back of here, we want you to get on the back of here and be part of this. This is an international move that we're making. We're going to hit the UN and everything else with this. It's time for us to do what? What's the call? What's the call? Yeah. Right on.
So that's very important. Now we're going to have, finally, we are going to conclude our event. Lenny, you want to come up here and do your... Lenny is going to lead us in the AIM song. So any people here who also know the AIM song, especially Native people, Patooch? Yes? Wait, Patooch is going to come up. All right.
Yeah.
Oh, that was beautiful. Just one thing I wanted to say that I forgot to say earlier. And people see in the back of their programs, there was a whole list of all these humanitarian things that Leonard Peltier has been doing from behind the walls for his people. And I think that it's important that people realize that, you know, that, yeah, the brother is innocent. Yeah, the brother's been framed. Yeah, the brother's been sitting in prison for a long, long time. But he's still doing the work from the inside. He's doing more work for his people from the inside, right, that many people are not doing on the outside. So one of the reasons I put on the back of the program this whole list of things that Leonard has done, things that he still does, and all these humanitarian awards that he's been given, you know, all over the world, all right? You know, that's very important. People need to realize that the man is a huge humanitarian. He's really serious. He has dedicated and sacrificed his life for his people. So it behooves us to step up and do the same. As my sister Safia Bukhari would say, we need to pick up the work and bring our prisoners home, all of them. Oh, so that's what we're going to do. That's our commitment for this year.
Hello, can I have your attention a minute? There's a very important strike going on in Colombia by the workers there, and we would like to send a statement of support to the workers in Colombia who are on strike. So those of you who would like to do that, please come on the stage, because we are going to record a support statement to the workers on strike in Colombia. So if you want to do that, please come on the stage now before you leave, so we could, and we have some support statements that we're gonna show. So come up and get one, and we'll send them a solidarity message. There's two things that we need you to do. During many of the people's strikes in Latin America, people say, huelga sí, entrega no. Huelga sí, huelga sí, which means yes to the strike, no to surrender. So please come up. And those of you who can, join us in sending a message to our sisters and brothers on strike in Colombia. Lucha sí.
Entrega no.
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 Can't hear you. Lucha sí.
Entrega no.
Lucha sí. Lucha sí. Lucha sí. La solidaridad no tiene fronteras. Solidarity has no borders. Thank you very much for being in solidarity con nuestros hermanos y hermanas en Colombia. Gracias.
And the Colombians also have another thing that they say when they're demonstrating. They say, no queremos, ni nos da la gana, ser una colonia norteamericana. Y si queremos, y si nos da la gana, ser un país libre y soberana. So that's a good chant. All right. We have to be out of this area because there is another event at 5:30. Oh, it's upstairs. Oh, okay, we're all right then. We don't have to be out of this area.